This is a 1987 Dodge B250. You probably don't know what that is unless you're up on your 1980s Dodge vans, but the point is, this is no ordinary Dodge van. It's been converted into a road trek RV, a camper, and the conversion happened back when it was new 35 years ago. Today, I'm going to review this van and take you on a tour of an RV relic from a different era. Before I get started, be sure to check out Cars and Bids, which is my enthusiast car auction website. We've had some amazing sales recently, including this Hennessy-tuned Mercedes E63 AMG, which sold for $36,500, this beautiful F10 BMW M5 in this like frozen silver color that sold for $42,500, and this Dodge Challenger Hellcat widebody, which sold for $63,000. If you're looking to sell your cool car from the 1980s and up, Cars and Bids is the best place to do it. You will get the most interest, the most views, and the most bids on your car, and we'll get it listed quickly. If you're looking to buy a cool car, check out our amazing selection and daily auctions at carsandbids.com. I've borrowed this van from a viewer here in the San Diego area, and I'm going to start with a little overview. Now, back in the 1960s, if you wanted a camper van to sleep in and take on road trips, you would use a Volkswagen bus. It was really popular for that purpose. These days, people use Sprinter vans, Mercedes-Benz Sprinters that have been outfitted for sleeping and camping, and they're huge and they work great. Well, in the 1980s, you might use this. Back then, conversion vans were popular. They were full-size vans that were converted from a simple passenger configuration to add luxury seating, TVs, VCRs, curtains, and in this case, even more, because this van was converted to be a full-on camper with a sink and a stove and a toilet and anything you could want if you were living life on the road. Most of these conversion vans didn't survive, as they were driven on long trips, long distances, and they weren't really worth much after 2-3 families had owned them, slept in them. No one really wanted to buy them. But this one has survived, tremendously well preserved, an RV van relic from the 1980s that has remained incredibly unscathed. So today I'm going to review this van and we're going to find out all about van life in 1987. First, I'm going to take you on a tour and show you all of the quirks and features of this van. There are many. Then I'm going to get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a DOUGSCORE. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of this van by telling you a little more about it. Now, earlier I said this was a Dodge B250, but as you can see, it is actually a Road Trek Versatile. Road Trek is the name of the company that converted this from a regular Dodge van into this cool RV camper thing. And one of the interesting things they did as part of the conversion process was make it longer. And you could actually see the spot where they took the regular Dodge van and just added to it a few extra feet in order to give it more space so they could put more RV stuff inside it. There's just this seam here, very obvious, very noticeable. This would never fly today, but it was fairly common practice with these vans back in the 1970s and 80s. Now, Road Trek, the company, they're based in Canada, and they are still making these RV vans. These days, they use Mercedes Sprinters and other similar vans, but back in the 80s, they did these. And they gave this one some wonderful touches. For example, they called it the Home and Park, you can see on the back. For some reason, in the 1980s, all RVs had to have some sort of name that connoted like a family outing. And so this one was the Home and Park. You also had stuff like the Summer Winds, other stupid names, and that was this. Another wonderful thing Road Trek gave this van was the stripes. These were original, put on by Road Trek 35 years ago, and they converted it gray and brown and orange. They go down the side, and there's even this little jog to make the stripes more exciting on the side of this van. What a 1980s look with these stripes on your Home and Park Road Trek camper. But anyway, next up, I'm gonna move inside the van. And of course, I'm gonna start in the back because that's where all the cool stuff is. You open up these doors to get into the back, and you discover initially a lot of brown back here. Basically every surface is brown. For instance, you have brown shag carpeting from the front that's carried a little bit into the back. You also have this sort of beige linoleum looking floor on the bottom. You have a brown wood look tabletop. You have brown in the front seat backs. You have brown below all the seats in this wood trim. Everything is brown. It was the color of the day, and this van clearly reflects that. These rear seats themselves are also brown, although Road Trek has given them an excellent little touch, these white squares throughout the brown seats in order to break up some of the brown. Nonetheless, it is still a bit of a brown explosion when you open these doors. But anyway, moving back here, let's talk about these seats. These back seats were intended for you to sit on while the van was in motion, and they have seat belts, so you can actually use them like traditional back seats. A couple of clever things. One is you can see the side corner has been cut off on the inside of both seats on either side. That is to allow easier access inside the van if you're moving around. That just makes it a little easier to get by the seats versus if the corners came all the way to their normal spot. It also gives you better access to the table. You have a table back here, a circular single post table mounted in between the back seats that you can use if the van is stopped to sit, eat, whatever, or if the van is moving, maybe you can play cards while you're on a road trip. That's a nice feature. I wish my vehicles had a table when I was a kid growing up. But even cooler than the table, you're sitting in these back seats, you look up and you can see there are windows on the roof facing out and forward, which is just the coolest thing. You're driving this van to go see the redwoods, the rear seat passengers can look up and see all of the trees or the night sky if you're camping or whatever, because there are windows on the ceiling. That is a nice little touch, and it makes it feel a lot more lighter and adventurier back here. I love it. But anyway, in this vicinity on the ceiling, you also have storage. Now, storage is a theme of this van. There is storage everywhere, as you will see. But I'm going to start with this panel up in the front, above the front seats. You pull it down, and then you have a nice little storage area where you can keep stuff if you don't want it rolling around. That's pretty cool. On the sides of that, also near the ceiling, you have these two long storage rails. One goes down the passenger side. You can see you can stick stuff up there, which could be handy. And same deal over on the driver's side. You have the same storage rail, a nice little convenient place to put stuff if you're sitting here or if you're driving along. Also worth noting, since I mentioned those ceiling windows earlier, on the subject of windows, I love the one in the back seat on this side of the van. You can see it's quite large. You have like a normal window and then it's even bigger, and it slides open so you can get a nice little breeze in here whether you're stopped or moving. You get on the outside, you can see it's quite a bit bigger than your traditional window like you see in the front door, so this is a nice addition. And again, if you're camping in your van, you have this extra window where you can see the wilderness, or you can just look at it while you're driving. Either way, it's nice to have. Now, you can see above the window, you have this folded up cloth, which is, of course, a curtain. Curtains are important on vans like this because you can sleep in here. I'll get to the bed in a minute. And so you want to be able to make it completely dark inside so you can easily sleep. So basically, every window has curtains. This one, of course, but even the front side windows have curtains that you can slide over to make it darker inside the van. You don't see too many front window curtains, but this van has them because it's an RV that you'll sleep in. Now back to this side window, above the curtains you have a little light. You can see this, and you press this little switch at the end and it turns on. There are lights like this all throughout the van. I will show them to you, but I just love you have like home lighting in here like you have in your house that you can turn on in various parts of the van depending on where you're eating or sleeping or reading or whatever. Now interestingly, over on the other side of the van you do not have a light in this position. Instead you have this little pad. That's because it's an area where you might hit your head if you're getting out of the van, so instead of just having the wood there, they've placed a pad over the wood to make it a little bit less painful if you do hit your head there. It's like this soft pad. That is some good, convenient thinking by Road Trek. But anyway, moving on from those back seats, because the quirks and features of this van are only just beginning back there, and you can clearly see that when you look further back and you see the kitchen in this van. Yes, it's a 1980s Dodge van, and yes, it has a kitchen. Now, the first thing you notice is undoubtedly this piece here, this large piece with a wood paneling on the front. This is the refrigerator. You unlock it with this little latch on the top, and then you open it up, and it's a fairly sizable little refrigerator with a freezer as well that you can use to keep your stuff cold or frozen while you're driving along, a very important component of a kitchen. Another important kitchen component is a sink, and this van has that too. You press this little switch that says on off on the front of the kitchen area, that turns on the water pump, then you go to the sink itself and you just turn the faucet like you would in your kitchen sink or your bathroom, and water comes out, and that's your sink, and you can use that to clean your hands or to clean off food before you make it or whatever. And you can make food in this van because you also have a stove. You have two burners in this stove. You can see right next to the sink, very convenient placement where you can boil water or whatever you need to do in order to cook food. And you can see that the area around the stove is all metal. Obviously, this is to reduce the fire risk with any other material. That probably is a nice safety touch. Above the stove, you have this black panel. Behind this is a fan, and it works. You turn it on and it will help dissipate gases from whatever it is that you're cooking, so you don't cause any problems, start a fire, whatever. Now, another important kitchen item, you might say, is a microwave. And if you're looking for one of those in this van, well, you're in luck. It has that too. Here is this van's microwave, and it looks like a fairly competent one, be it pretty small, but a microwave nonetheless. And again, you can use this to microwave food just like you would in a normal kitchen. So, refrigerator, stove, sink, microwave, that's a kitchen. And here it is in your van. Now, this kitchen also has some other nice kitchen accessories. One is storage. Like I mentioned, this van is all about storage in here, and that especially includes the kitchen. You have this cabinet below everything. You can open it up, and you can see some good shelving where you can keep stuff. You also have two slide-out drawers, one below the stove and one over on the other side of your countertop. You also, above all of your kitchen supplies, have a cubby right here between the microwave and the stove fan, and then above that, you have another cubby you can open for even more storage. You can keep your utensils, your cooking supplies, basically everything you need in all of your little cubbies in your little kitchen. It's surprisingly useful. You also have two other excellent kitchen accessories in here. One is this little light right above the sink, so you can turn this on to see food prep and make sure you don't accidentally cut yourself or whatever. That is a nice touch you'd expect from any kitchen, including the one in your van. Also, I love the fact that behind the sink you have a window, just like you would want in a kitchen. You're doing dishes, you want to be able to look out and not be completely bored. So they've given you a window behind your sink like most actual kitchens have. I like that. It's a nice touch. But the kitchen is nothing. Undoubtedly the best thing in this van, the pièce de résistance, the finest item in here is the toilet. Yes, there is a toilet. It's inside this cabinet, which you can see is locked. You unlock the cabinet, open the doors, and there is the toilet. You can sit down and go to the bathroom in your van. There's a little flusher on it, and it empties out into a little tank at the bottom of the van for waste that you can hook up to a sewer connection and empty out. But let's talk toilet for a second. Very small, but reasonably useful. My favorite thing about the toilet is the doors that surround it, because check this out. The doors are built so they can be completely folded out, and they are cut to perfectly fit around the kitchen so that the door can be used as like a wall if you're actually using the toilet and you want some privacy. You can see the door perfectly fits up with the built-in space for the kitchen, and then you have basically a wall there. And there's even a little lock that you can put on so that nobody can enter your door if you're using the bathroom, and it works the same on the other side. You can open up the door, again, cut out perfectly to fit into this space, so now you have a wall. And when the doors are in this position, you now have a completely enclosed private area where you can use the bathroom, and also it contains the kitchen. So you have the old bathroom kitchen double area. This van is certainly practical, but it's not exactly huge, so some compromises like that have to be made. One other item worth noting about the toilet, right above the toilet, there is another light. You turn that on, and you have a light, as you would expect, in your bathroom. in your van. Now, next up, before I discuss this table and chairs that I'm sitting on back here, one important thing is on the ceiling of this van, and that would be controls for the air conditioner. You can see you can turn it on and have air conditioning in this van. Not a huge vent or air conditioner situation, but this isn't a huge space, and it cools the van down. You can see the air conditioner itself is mounted on the roof of the van, so you want to be careful if you're driving this, you don't go into any low clearance areas because it will take off your air conditioner, but that's how it works and that's how to control it. Maybe more interesting is the fact that you also have a heater in here. You can turn on the heat and look at how you do that. There is a household style heater control mounted in the back of the van, so you just turn the heat up to the temperature you want, just like you would do in a house from this era. It's crazy to see that in a vehicle, and the owner tells me it works just fine and keeps the van warm if you need it. And finally, I want to move on to the back of the Road Trek to show off what I was sitting on before, and that would be this little sort of picnic area back here. Again, filled with browns. Brown shag carpeting back here again. Brown tabletop, brown seat with those little white dots. Brown below the seats, brown wood paneling, brown curtains, brown everywhere. That was the color that Road Trek was sticking with. Now, obviously, you can figure out why it would be important to have a little picnic seating, eating area in a vehicle like this. You're parked somewhere, you want to have a meal, you can do it back here, and you can probably get 6 people around this table if they all squeeze, maybe even 8. That's a pretty good situation. But then you're wondering, well, where is the bed? Doesn't this RV thing have a bed? Isn't the whole point of it you can use it to camp? And the answer, of course, is yes. This rear area converts into a bed. You remove this table, which is a pretty simple process, and then you kind of fold the cushions flat, and you have a bed back here. The owner tells me he's about 6 feet tall and he sleeps in this bed relatively comfortably, maybe a little bit at an angle, but it is doable. So you can sleep in the back of your van after you've cooked yourself a nice meal in your kitchen. Now, a couple of interesting things in this area. One, again, all the lighting. Right above the table, you have this large circular light. You press this button in the center and it lights up this area. You also have individual lights over both of the benches back here. You also have an electrical outlet back here. So you can plug in and charge your devices, devices that weren't even invented in 1987 when that electrical outlet was originally installed. Now also above this whole eating and bed area, you have a few more storage cubbies back here. Again, storage is the name of the game for this van. You open up these cubbies and you can put even more stuff back here to get it out of place so it won't be flying around while you're driving. And by the way, speaking of storage, below the rear bench over on the passenger side, you can see it bulges out a little bit and it's sort of circular. That's because the spare tire is kept in this spot, so it's right there if you need it. Pretty clever, convenient storage place. Next up, we move on to the side of the van and this panel, which is important because it contains your hookups, specifically your hookups for propane and electrical. If you want to park somewhere like an RV park, you hook that up here and you can power some of the items that are inside the van by opening up this panel. Now, the water hookup is a bit of a different situation. To access that, you open the front passenger door and you can see there's like a little screw nozzle area. You stick a garden hose basically into this spot and then you can fill it with up to 20 gallons of water. And the owner told me you stop when water starts coming out. I asked him, how far does 20 gallons get you? And he said, well, because this van doesn't have a shower, you can actually do pretty well with 20 gallons. He's gone 3 or 4 days camping with his van without filling it up on just 20 gallons filled up before he left. And finally, we move up to the front of this van where you have pretty much the kind of quality you would have expected from a Chrysler interior at this time period, which is to say, not much quality. Take a look, for instance, at the steering wheel. You have just 2 spokes, horn in the middle, very cheap plastic, the whole thing doesn't look all that great. Although my personal favorite cheap plastic spot is in the center. You can see the owner has installed this wood cup holder area, but if you remove that, you just have this molded plastic giant panel with these crappy shallow cup holders. No attempt made to make this look good or to even make it practical, because you can see there's no storage here. There's no center storage cubbies or anything, and there's no door panel storage. So you want to put your wallet somewhere in this van, you're kind of screwed while you're driving. You have have to put it up above your head, which isn't something you do in most vehicles. Now, as for the dashboard itself, the controls, the climate vents, this stuff is all pretty standard from this time period. Very simple, nothing unusual or exciting or weird in here. Just very easy, very 1980s basic car kind of stuff. Although I will say, I do like on the dashboard, way over on the passenger side, you have a little badge that says custom engineered Ram Tough. Yeah, that's right. Custom engineered Ram Tough van. Finally, one other thing I like in this van up front is this little quarter window in the front, this little vent window. You twist this latch and then you can open this window, and it's such a wonderful touch. It gives you nice airflow while you're driving around. If you don't want to use the air conditioning, you can just have that open and get a little breeze. I loved when cars used to have these windows. No cars do anymore, and it's such a shame because they were so nice and so useful. And so those are the quirks and features of this wonderful 1980s camper van. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the van. And I start off going up a big hill coming out of the owner's house. And I gotta tell you, not a whole lot of power in this vehicle. This has some big old V8, I think just under 5 liters, and probably about 170 horsepower or something that was acceptable at the time, but of course is now laughable by modern standards. It gets up the hill, but it's not excited to get up the hill. With that said, I must say, once you drive it on normal roads, not with a crazy grade like that one, it actually feels pretty reasonable. You know, I've driven some Sprinters and some Quigley E-Series vans, those conversions with four-wheel drive, and those things feel pretty ponderous. This surprisingly feels maybe a little bit less so. I suspect part of the reason for that is it's just smaller than those vehicles. So even though it's old school transmission, that sort of thing, it just doesn't have quite the size that those vehicles have that really kind of makes them feel huge and unmaneuverable. It is interesting, really, driving the van, at least from the seating position up here, you just don't really feel like it's all that big. You feel like you're in pretty good control. I will say, when I look in the mirror, I look back there and it's like I'm driving a bus. It's like, whoa, that? I'm in that? I think part of the reason that it doesn't feel that big is because these old Dodge vans, the engine and the passenger compartment is almost flat front. That was how vans were for a long time, like in the 70s. And by the 80s, they still kind of had that look. And so you're really far forward in it. It doesn't feel like you're piloting this massive vehicle, even though, well, you are. Now, I'm filming this video up in Carlsbad, one of the beach cities north of San Diego. And if you know the area, you know there's a huge van culture here. There's become, in the surf world and like the van life world, a lot of these people live in this area, and these vans are like everywhere. These lifted Sprinters and surf vans, and everybody has, I mean, they're all over the place. You can't drive around and not see two or three. But this absolutely stands out. Just this old school road trek with these graphics in this condition. And the owner told me people are stopping him, talking to him about it all the time. Where did you get that? How old is it? That sort of thing. Now, I'm taking it out on the highway, and I was kind of curious to do that because, I mean, it's this old van with not much power, and I thought it'd be a disaster. But the owner says, no, he said the highway is what it's built for, and he's been back and forth with it to South Dakota several times where he has family. And it's been no problem. And I'm like, really? This thing? I said, yeah, try it. And I have to say, it's actually better than I expected. I'm going 60 now. Not incredibly fast by any stretch, but it feels comfortable. It feels like it's reasonably well together. You can drive this long distances, I guess, and you have cruise control. So, you know, it's a reasonably drivable vehicle. You just don't have the world's most comfortable seat. And you lose some modern conveniences. No navigation, no anti-lock brakes. It is carbureted. Overall, though, I gotta say, surprisingly well-balanced and acceptable on the freeway. Obviously, a lot of float in the steering, although maybe not quite as much as I was expecting. It actually drives better than I thought it would, given, you know, you look at it, you see this old Dodge, it's gonna be a disaster, and then it's even bigger, and all these stuff put on it, but it actually is okay. All right, I'm flooring it now. It's not fast. I wouldn't call it fast by any stretch of the imagination, but it gets up to the speed that you need it to eventually, and it's not so slow that it's unsafe. Like, I'm at the end of the on-ramp and I'm going 65, that's fine. Really, it's just kind of a bizarre, fun, interesting vehicle. I think most of the fun of it would come with camping with it, using it how you're supposed to, kind of taking advantage of all of its comforts, if you will. This would be a cool van to take out camping, and you'd certainly stand out in the campground among all of the, you know, Sprinters and people in 4Runners and Tacomas with tents. You show up with this, people are like, wow, that guy, Well, I don't know what they're saying about you, but they're certain to notice. And I would turn my head if I saw this on the road, for sure.
And so that's the 1987 Dodge B250 Road Trek Camper. I am amazed by this thing, amazed by how well-preserved it is, but also just very interested to see how people lived before sprinters with their flat-screen TVs and video game systems and power doors. Life wasn't quite as cushy back in 1987. Anyway, now it's time to give this van a DOUGSCORE.
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, this van isn't attractive. It's a big van, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Acceleration, it's slow, and it gets a 1 out of 10. Handling is what you'd expect for a van like this, and it gets a 2 out of 10. Fun factor is low. It's not exactly made for fun, and it gets a 1 out of 10. Cool factor is a bit higher, though, as you never see these in this condition. It's kind of a neat thing, and it gets a 4 out of 10 for a total weekend score of 11 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. This van doesn't have any modern tech, but it does have a kitchen and a bathroom. It deserves a bit of a score boost for those things, so it gets a 4 out of 10. Comfort is okay, about what you'd expect, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Quality is fine, it's not especially high quality, materials aren't that great, but it's easy to work on, I have no doubt, it gets a 5 out of 10. Practicality is pretty good, since you can basically live in it, it loses a point only for fuel economy, and it gets a 9 out of 10. Finally, value, and these aren't tremendously expensive, but they're cool and very novel, and it gets a 6 out of 10 for a total daily score of 29 out of 50. Added up, and the DOUGSCORE is 40 out of 100, which places it here against some other vans, although this isn't really a fair comparison, because none of these vans are RVs. This Dodge van is old and slow, and not very high tech, but it's also pretty cool and quirky, and it still gets a higher score than the Mercedes Metris.